worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Friends, what deficiencies actually defines a fool? A certain bhikkhu once asked the Blessed Buddha, "Venerable Sir, it is said, a simple fool, in what way, Venerable Sir, can one rightly be called a simple fool?" Bhikkhu, it is because one has neither developed nor ever cultivated these seven links to awakening that one rightly is called a simple fool. What seven? One, the awareness link to awakening. Two, the investigation link to awakening. Three, the energy link to awakening. Four, the joy link to awakening. Five, the tranquility link to awakening. Six, the concentration link to awakening. And seven, the equanimity link to awakening. It is because one has neither developed nor ever cultivated these seven factors of enlightenment that one rightly is called a simple fool. What to train when the mind is sluggish, slow, and low? The Blessed Buddha one explains, on any occasion, bhikkhus, when the mind is sluggish, slow, and low, then it is suitable to develop the investigation of states linked to awakening, the energy linked to awakening, and the joy linked to awakening. Why is it so? Because then when the mind is sluggish, slow, and low, then it's easy to arouse, incite, stir, and stimulate with exactly these states. Imagine bhikkhus, a man wants to make a small fire flare up. If he throw dry grass, dry cow dung, dry timber into it, blows on it, and does not scatter soil over it, would he be able to make this small fire flare up? Yes, indeed, Venerable Sir. Similarly here, and then any occasion when the mind is sluggish, slow, and low, then it's time to develop the investigation of states linked to awakening, the energy linked to awakening, and the joy linked to awakening. Why so? Because when the mind is sluggish, slow, and low, then it's easy to arouse, incite, stir, and stimulate with the qualities of exactly these states. What to train then when the mind is high and alert? The Blessed Buddha once explained, on any occasion, because when the mind is excited and high, then it's time to train the tranquility link to awakening, the concentration link to awakening, and the equanimity link to awakening. Why is it so? Because then when the mind is excited and high, because then it's easy to calm it down with exactly those states. Imagine because a man wants to extinguish a great fire. If he throws wet grass, wet cow dung, and wet timber into it, sprays it with water, and scatter soil over it, would it be able to extinguish that great bonfire? Yes, Venerable Sir. Even so here, bhikkhus, on any occasion when the mind is excited and high, then it's convenient to train and develop the tranquility link to awakening, the concentration link to awakening, and the equanimity link to awakening. Why is it so? Because when the mind is excited and high, bhikkhus, then it's easy to calm down and still with the qualities of exactly those mental states. Awareness, however, bhikkhus, I tell you, is always useful and good to train. Agitation and irritation can thus be converted by advantageous alertness. Then one remains ultra aware and acutely alert, but not the least agitated. It's from the Sabbyuttanikaya, the Connected Discourses of the Buddha, Book 46, Sutta number 44, Unintelligent, and 53, Fire. Thank you.
Hey, Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air number 91, recorded under the cypress tree beside the Cypress hermitage in central hill country, Sri Lanka. A very, very nice, warm, breezy day in February 2018. There are three questions, as usual. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. Indeed. Before we start the trailing at the questions, Lynn, I'd like again to remind you to subscribe to this channel, because it's literally speaking a ticket to Nirvana, because one is reminded about the Noble Eightfold Way, and subscribing is down in this corner. Small red sign, turn your mobile phone horizontal, then you can see it. And if you already have subscribed, click the small bell down there so you're being notified. And if you like the videos, also click the like, the thumb up sign, because this will make YouTube advertise this particular videos more, so that others get a chance to see it also. For those who do not get the Dhamma drop emails from the old group, which is defunct, the old Buddha Direct group, please subscribe to the link here, googlesgroup.com/forum/BuddhaDirect2. I will give a link to the subscribe place underneath here and in the video and audio description too. I can also recommend for those who like to hear the Dhamma via audio while I do something else, driving or whatever, to go to my profile at soundcloud.com. Just search for Bhikkhu Samahita. There are all the audio tracks to these videos, plus other audio tracks on guided meditations, are deposited. I also made a new profile, Samahita Theta, at spreaker.com, another podcast site, recently. So it's good to follow or subscribe there too. Lastly, I'd like to remind about the two meditation courses, one here in June 2018 and one late in December, 20th December to 1st January 2019 in North Carolina, USA. They are both available, descriptions and programs are both available at the front page of whatbuddhasaid.net. And everybody is, of course, welcome. Yeah, just a little update here in the setting sun about the construction project. As you can see, so we finished making reinforcement here on the middle wall. So the pillars there, they will be as strong as the pillars here, which are supported by at least, because they're not dig down in the ground. Can I come down in the ground, because there's cliff down there. Very difficult to get to dig out hole in solid rock cliff. But otherwise, we are ready to rock with the pillars here, starting to make them. And then when the pillars are finished, then we will have to finish up this 2 feet deep hole. And this rock you see here, flat rock, we can lift 3 men. I think it's maybe 150 kilo, and put up on this place here. Before we fill up the hole, we put it up here. This should be where I sit and talk. And another issue is this rock down here, this fellow, I guess, which is around a ton, This we have to move slowly on steel bars. And then we'll make a small hill here up to the cement foundation. And then we will slowly whack it up to around this place here, right there, and for the Buddha statue. So this is where the Buddha statue will stand. So behind here with the red, so people can sit here to the right and to the left. And then I will sit in front of the Buddha statue, and then people will sit here and here. And then there will be open. And as you can see, this is, I'm now walking on floor level. So this means one can just look out on the top of the fence to one side, and there one can see the entire valley. I'll keep it open, and one can see the Knuckles Mountain up there. Today very clear, also very hot. And to the other side, if one go down here to the other side of the meditation hall, then one will be able to see look right over the jungle here and into the forest and up the mountain. So it will be a fairly nice view all the way around when it's finished. I guess there can easily be 100, 150 people in here. My guess will be something like that, sitting at least. So a great place for communication. I probably use a projector to show videos or whatever, film, but later on maybe some flat screens for permanent installations for higher education of all who are interested in that. Again, to those who have supported this project, thank you so very much for your support. May your karmic elevation be gigantic. And there you see the last portion we made some days ago. And here is the iron for the pillars, which we will start to put up in not very long time. So thank you for your support. And may you have a nice life and easy access to Nirvana for the support of this Dhamma Sangha. Thank you and have a nice day.
Yes, friends, remembering death and what is on the other side of this crucial event is often useful when enhancing one's altruistic activities. For the Buddha said, on the other side of death is only what we did on this side of death, what we did in this life and in our prayer lives. And whatever support that of probability, uplifting support of probability, that is basically our good doing to others and to the world in general. That is our altruistic activities, minus, subtracted, whatever evil, detrimental, wrong we did in this life and in all our past lives. So it's worth noticing that this is the only support, the Buddha said, for beings is their good karma. Here in Sri Lanka called pin karma. When you go into temples, you will often see people cleaning, voluntarily cleaning the floor, or brooming, or ordering the flowers. So here's a very acute understanding of the necessity of doing something good for others. Whether it's donating to a meditation hall, or to a Dhamma book being published, or to Dhamma videos being published, anything that helps other beings approach Nibbana, approach peace, approach lasting happiness that will increase one's own probability and ability to approach Nirvana and thereby reach the end of suffering. So, creating opportunities for others creates opportunities for oneself. Thank you. Actually, when working myself on this project of building a meditation hall, I feel a great satisfaction because I know I do something good for others. And when you do something altruistic, then you also feel a great satisfaction. You are like lighted up by an inner fire and become very happy and satisfied by doing this good. Knowing that many of the donors and many others also, of course, will come and meditate in this meditation hall for the next 20 years. This makes me very happy. So they can approach Nirvana. They can become more free, more happy, more peaceful, and have a greater insight into the absolute nature of reality.
Question 271. What was the daily routine of the Lord Buddha? Yes, he had kind of like five parts, very active gentleman, only sleep 1 to 2 hours a day on average. The morning session, which goes from 4 to 12 noon, 4 a.m. to 12 noon, he would get up and then wash his face and then sit for 1 or several hours doing sitting meditation. Then he would scan the world with his Buddha eye, an enhanced version of the Dipachaku, the divine eye, the all-seeing eye, and then see if anybody will need his help today, and if he can do anybody anything. And this is what he will typically do. Then before noon, he will go out, or in the afternoon, whatever time was suitable, to help these beings that needed his help. Then around 6 o'clock, he will put up his robe and take his bowl and then go begging round, while he was looking down, either alone or with a single row of monks. Or he will be invited, got an invitation for a meal some days before, and then he will go to that particular house. After this receiving food, one you typically say 4 lines of thanks if you're in front of a house on begging round, and if you are in a house, you give a so-called bana, a Dhamma speech after the meal, before you go back to the monastery. From 12 noon to 6 p.m. in the evening, the Buddha will advise the monks, give Buddha speeches, or he will take personal interviews with the various monks that came to his hut. They will typically come to his hut, and then they will be instructed by the other monks to say like this outside his door, and then he will open his door and come out, and then they could talk. Again, for the second time during the same day, he would scan the entire world and see if any beings were ready for the Dhamma and need his help. Then he would go there either through a mental body, manomaya body, an emanation, so to speak, a psychic made hologram, and speak to them. They would not know that it was a hologram, or he would go there with his physical body at whatever distance it was. People will also come to him and meet him during this time. Lay people will come to him in great masses, and he will speak to them either separately or in groups, either inside the monastery or wherever they were, giving joy to the wise, promoting the intelligence of the average people, and dispelling the darkness of the dull-witted. Again, giving joy to the wise, promoting the intelligence of the average people, and dispelling the darkness of the dull-witted. So all will get something. In the first watch of the night, which is from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m., then again his followers, disciples, will come and speak to him. Or he will, to clarify their doubts, or he will go to the Dhammasala, the Dhamma hall in the particular monastery, or in the forest, there will be an opening, and speak to the monks of whatever issue was pressing at that time. At the middle watch of the night, from 10 to 2 p.m., or from 10 p.m. to 2 a.m., then the deities, Devas, will typically come and stand to one side. Either he would meditate, or the Devas will come to stand on one side, usually lighting up the entire monastery to ask their questions and to clarify their doubts. Next day, from 2 a.m. to 4 a.m., he will walk up and down, do walking meditation, and then typically sleep 1 hour. And then the next day will start. So one can see that the Buddha say are extremely energetic. Sometimes he will say that it is in the hot summer season, it is also allowable for a Buddha to sleep 1 hour during the midday after the meal. But this is not something regular done. But on average, he will sleep 1 hour for 24 hours. So very active, active all the time, both day and night, advising people or scanning to search up. So they are very, very active in their last life, delivering what they have trained to deliver for billions of existences. May all beings be happy and well and attain the fruit of Nibbana by hearing this. Then there is, why did he need 6 years to awaken while the other Buddhas sometimes only need 1 week? Yes, during the Buddha Kassapa, the former Buddha, there's been four Buddhas: Kunagamana, Kagosanda, Kassapa, and Gautama. Gautama was the fourth. Metteya has yet to come. He will come in 576 million years. But Gautama, he was then also a disciple under Kassapa Buddha. But before he became a disciple, then he was a young Brahmin, young priest, high class, high caste, young man who had a low caste friend called Gatikara, the potmaker's son. And they were out bathing in the river one day. And then Gatikara said, "Ah, Buddha Kassapa sits up in this forest grove. Let's go and see him after we finish this bath." And then Gautama have told himself that he said, "Ah, this bald head, this shaveling, I don't want to see." So he used a derogative word in contempt of Kassapa because he was a Hindu priest. And very well versed in the ancient text of the Hindus. So in the Vedas, so he didn't feel any need to go to a competing, as what he thought, perceived as a competing religious sect leader. So Gatikara asked him again. Gatikara was a very devout Buddhist. Gatikara asked him again, "Friend, it is good to see the Buddhas because the Buddhas are very, very rare. Buddha Kassapa sits up in this forest. Let's go and see him after this bath." And then Buddha Gautama's former rebirth again said, "Ah, no, I don't want to see these bald heads, these shavelings." And then Gatikara, which was not allowed to touch him because Gatikara was low caste, pot maker, huh? And this was a Brahmin priest with some special hair knots. He was not allowed to touch him. But nevertheless, he took him by the hair and pulled him down under the water until he was almost drowning. Hold him there until he felt that now it was enough. He was almost drowning. Then he took him up and say, "Can you understand? We have to go." And then Buddha Gautama's former rebirth, the Bodhisattva, he said, "Ah, yes, yes." He agreed to go there. Then he went. They went up there, and then Buddha Kassapa had only to tell him little, very little of the Dhamma. Then Gautama's Bodhisattva, he decided to ordain right there on the spot. He never returned to his father's house. So he left his own tradition and he left his Brahmin pride right on the very spot there. This just shows up that you can be born into a life, you've been Buddhist many times, maybe very advanced Buddhist, but and you're maybe one stop shot of awakening, but still, due to social convention, If you're not enlightened, then you live up in the social convention and follow the social convention, whatever it may be. But at a given time point in life, usually after some kind of shock, one suddenly turns one's eye to the Dhamma again, and then one quickly regains one's old level. The things falls out like this, that Gatikara become a Brahma Deva from level 12 to 26 up, the fine material Devas, Brahma Devas, or form level, rupa level Devas, and then comes in the form of a rupa deva and asks Buddha Gautama later on, when he has become enlightened, whether he can recognize him. And then the Buddha Gautama can recognize him. Then this is lives later where the Buddha has become a Buddha, and Gatikara, he's now a shining Brahma god. So the two old friends meet again. And of course, Buddha Gautama shows gratitude towards Gatikara to show him Buddha Kasapa, his teacher, both in the life where it happened and also in the much later life where he himself becomes a Buddha. So friendship can sometimes last many lives, many, many lives. But they said it's because of this, he himself has told on that this was because of this twice rejecting Buddha Kasapa and used a derogative about this shaveling, this bald head, that he has to go 6 years through various austerities and self-torture, starve himself to the extent that his hair will fall off if he strokes his body. He could feel the aorta and the columna through his stomach. He will faint. If he tried to urinate or defecate, then he will fall right on his face. His skin was black, so he has necrotic skins. Just like after a serious frostbite, for example. Or if you get blood perfusion to a leg, then it basically becomes black and dry. Black, dry necrosis. This he has over most of his body. So many thought he was dead. So he tortured himself because of this former derogatory remark twice about the Buddha just before him, actually. And this is typical of a karmic response, that it is not something that is imposed by you. You're not run down by a truck. The karmic response often is working the way in the way that the individual themselves take unfortunate choices that makes him suffer. As in this case, the Buddha denied to eat anything. He starved himself. Seriously. There's a picture here. So this is very typical, you see. Same thing with suicide, or slandering your money, or taking the wrong education, or picking the wrong wife, or whatever. One's own choices is highly influenced by one's past karma. Good as bad. Good karma will make you make the right choice, the happy choice, the successful choice. While bad karma will make you take the wrong road, the evil road, make the bad choices, the downfall choices, the painful choices, the unhealthy choices. So you can try to evaluate yourself whether you know all circumstances that are present in your mind when you make a choice A and not B, C, D, E, and F. Why did you choose A in the first place? Usually this is difficult to delineate. There can be many intentions, some subconscious, some semi-conscious, some fully conscious, but basically it's overlapping intentions and overlapping arguments. But which one was a deciding factor can often be difficult to unravel. What is the karmic effect of helping to build monastic buildings such as your meditation pavilion at the Cypress Hermitage? Yes, traditionally it said that you can give four things. You can give food, clothes, medicine, and buildings. And the last thing is this building. And this we regard as the highest, so it gives a full-blown karmic effect. Why so? Because karmic buildings protect those who seek nibbana from everything, robbers, weather, lightning, rain, worms, snakes, centipedes, mosquitoes, what have you. So it's a protector of everything. Since one gives a protector of everything, one also gains a protector of everything in the future life. And this means one's success, one's obstructions will be removed. One has a free walk towards whatever success is needed. So it will be felt as a freedom of choice on all levels and regarding all issues and things. In particular, now you ask about a meditation building, the meditation hall here, where people will come, both lay and monastics will come and meditate and hear the Dhamma. Then it has another particular factor for this particular purpose that goes beyond, for example, giving a monastic kitchen or a monastic sleeping hall. Then one will gain much more easy access to Nirvana. This means that one's distance to nobility, to stream entry, will be much shorter. And one will have a much more easy access, much more easy training towards this stream entry point. And from stream entry point toward all the other stages of once returner, Sakadagami, never returner, Anagami, and then also Arahant stage. Because this is exactly what one gives to others. One gives the way, a swift way to others. One doesn't even know them. So one gives indiscriminately. And that's the best way you can give. And this is when the Kammic return will be a profuse and profound and long lasting. Universal cycles lasting. More easy access to Nirvana. More easy access to nobility. More easy access to success on the pillow while meditating. So that's of course number one to get from a Buddhist point of perspective. Easy access to Nirvana. So one doesn't have to work so hard to get this very subtle state. Question 272. The human body is a living and ever-changing organism, exchanging oxygen and food and excrement with the surroundings, always becoming new. Why do humans then think there is a self or a soul permanently residing inside the body? Is it craving for everlasting permanence, or is it blindness to impermanence? Or is it identification? I think the first reason is basically that what you see, first of all, let's say inside the womb, then the fetus that is conscious touches the wall of the womb, gets some sensation in the fingers, but another sensation of the womb. Then they say, this is the sensation in the fingers, when it touches this one, legs, then it gets sensation in the fingers and sensation in the legs also. But if they touch a womb, then they get no sensation of the womb, only sensation in his fingers. Then it says the legs and the fingers are internal. It's pre-language, huh? Doesn't have any language yet, but it's identified with it. The identification process is already ongoing there, as internal, as me, as something separate from the surrounding that is external, that is others, or outside world. And this even become even stronger when you look yourself in the mirror, brushing teeth or wherever, and when other points to your body, then they identify your identity with the body, because this is what they can see. Huh? And you do the same while brushing teeth in the front of the mirror. So people will tend to identify with this frame. The first foundation of awareness, the first satipatthana, is actually seeing this form only as a frame of something changing, not as me, not as mine, not as what I am, not what I am made of, because it's ever changing. Huh? You breathe out. Do you breathe in some of your ego out in every breath? It's absurd, huh? What about peeing and excrementing? Is some of your ego, your soul, your everlasting identity going down the drain there? Ah, I'm losing my ego. No. So of course not, there is no ego, there is no self to lose. There is nothing in the body that is ever permanent. But I think it's a mixture, first, of this psychological mechanism. And it has been proven in modern psychology experiments, first of all with the rubber hand experiment. I'll give to a link it, I have a video about it. Basically, if you take, there's a hand, and then you have a rubber hand, and then you conceal the real hand for the man, he can only see in a mirror, can only see this hand, and then the rubber hand, and both hands are in gloves. And then you bang the rubber hand, and then he pulls the other hand. So this means that he has, but just by very short time, by being stroken with a brush on both hands, then his ego identification has been transferred from the real hand he cannot see to the rubber hand he can see in the mirror. So now he thinks that this rubber hand is his, is me, is my, is what I am. So if you bang it down, then he will track his real hand he cannot see. And this means that he has identified with the rubber hand. Numerous other experiments show the same. So it's a process where the mind projects I, me, self to some certain perceptions. And it's very mobile. It can be reprogrammed in seconds, as this rubber hand experiment shows. So you could say biologically it makes sense, because if you perceive this body as you, then if there's a tiger, then you run away and protect this body, and thereby the genes, bring the genes evolutionary into the next generation. But happiness-wise, it doesn't make sense, because this thinking this body is me, is what I am, then subconsciously and immanently defines the purpose of life as gratifying this body with sense pleasure, at whatever cost, including at whatever cost of pain for other beings. And there, this idea of I, me being the body runs into serious problems, because the probabilistic ego of hurting other beings on account of your own pleasure, this gives pain down the road for the very same body in humongous amounts. As the example of the Buddha, just mentioning two times another being, in fully self-enlightened Sammasambuddha, being a baldling, then this made him torture himself for 6 years. 6 years. Until death, or very close to death, imminent death. So it doesn't make sense on the long run. And this you see very often. One's emotional response, running away from pain and running towards pleasure, doesn't work on the long run, works well on the very short time range. Saying no to a vaccine, for example, that could save you from cancer because there's a small painful prick, it doesn't make sense. Huh? Saying yes to morphine injection and thereby becoming a drug addict because there's pleasure in the morphine, connected with getting morphine into the brain and thereby become a morphinist, usually dying before the age of 40, after having lived as a prostitute, a horrible life, often on the streets. This doesn't make sense. Huh? So it looks like pleasure, short-term pleasure, but it gives long-term pain. It looks like short-term pain, but it gives long-term projection, protection, and long-term happiness. So the affectionate emotional reaction is often something else, short-term, mid-term, and long-term. And one should of course look for the long-term, not for the short-term. This takes mindfulness, awareness, wisdom, and a good deal of contemplation and training. So in short, I think it's a mixture of craving for permanence, ignorance of the no-self doctrine, and blindness, perceptual blindness to the obvious impermanence, both of one's own body. Obviously, one doesn't look like the baby one were 50 years ago, and neither do the old man with a long beard. Huh? He doesn't look the baby. He's not. There's no molecules in him who's the same. So, and same thing with any other body, and seen on a quantum mechanical scale, no part of matter is the same from one moment to the next moment. So how can there be any? And same thing goes with all feelings, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. Nothing in the of the mental constituents of this body and mind, this nama rupa, is the same from 1 second, 1 millisecond, 1 billionth of a second to the next billionth of a second. How can there be anything same? But this, everybody can see change, there's change going on, otherwise this will be a still picture. But it's a video, so it's obviously there is change, but it's concealed by what Buddha Gosa called apparent continuity. So since it looks like a continuous, since this has there's some similarity in there, the monk has still a red robe of aqua, it's the same monk. The tree looks approximately the same, so it's the same tree. No, it's the same designation, it's the same name, but it's not the same object. It's a similar object. It's a discrete contiguity, continuation of the same object, but it's a not a continuous stream. It's a discrete stream. Like pictures on an analog film, or like frames in a video, where every single frame is still, nothing happens. Then there's the next frame, the next frame, the next frame, the next frame, the next frame. Inside the single frame, how should there be any self there? Then it should be a frozen self. And between the frames, what's going on there? There's a kind of like a no frame or a change of frames. How should there be a self there or a substance there? It's impossible. But one has to reflect on because it's this notion of a self, of a permanent me, mind, that is unchanging throughout time. This one has entertained for a very long time, also as insect or as devas. Basically is identification with some form or a name, designation, whatever this designation may be. But the ants do the same, and all beings do the same. They think they are separate and the same from birth to death. The same person, the same identity, the same individuality. While this more should be seen like a flowing river, like a process. The river is not the banks, it's the water in the river. And the river, whatever you dip your toe in or make a transverse section of the water in the river, then it's something new. It's something new. It's always something new. But the name of the river, Ganges or Mississippi, is the same. But it's just a designation for a process that is ever changing. At the moment the river runs, the river water runs out into the ocean, it loses its name. It blends with all other water and cannot be designated anymore. And this is a good picture for the being entering Nirvana, because then he or she or it cannot be designated anymore. Cannot be pointed out, cannot be measured, cannot be even imagined. Just like the water running out into the ocean. I think very, very, good picture and also very beautiful picture of the process of entering Nirvana, Parinibbana. Question 273. Do devas in the kama-loka level 6 to 11 eat food and excrete excrement? Yes, just again, the basic Buddhist cosmology is 31 levels of existence. You see them depicted here. We are in the lowest 11 levels, which is where we are level 5, human are level 5, and then there are some from level 6 to 11, 11, there are 5 divine levels of higher and higher subtlety. Then there is a fundamental shift, all in the lower levels in kama-loka, they are have only sense pleasure on their mind, they are driven by sense pleasure. Us and the lower devas and the animals and the ghosts and asuras and so on. I made in a whole video about it. I give the link up here. The 31 levels of existence. And I'll also give some link in the video description to a overview of the description of the 31 levels of existence, conscious existence. Just so, in the kama-loka is this a fairly low level of devas that are described to be also in war and copulate and have sex and drink alcoholic drinks or at least intoxicating drinks and so on, and have various desires and aversions. The question is here, do they also eat and excrete excrement? Yes, they do eat and excrete excrement. At a higher level, it just be much more subtle food, but more delicious and supple food than our food. But basically the same food as we, made out of atoms, protons, neutrons, electrons, and configurations of those into various molecules, organic molecules. And they also have excrement and urine. And it's said that when they have excrement and urine, then spontaneously a cloud comes around them when they pass excrement. So they have no toilet, but they are just concealed naturally by a small cloud from the other devas. So they do go to the toilet. What about the devas in the rupa-loka, the fine material worlds, level 12 to level 26? This is from the Brahma level and upwards. Some of them, the shining devas up there, the Abhasara devas, are made of light and feet of joy. And they still have form, but it's a fine material form, which I think corresponds to what we call dark matter, which constitutes a fairly large part of the mass of the universe, probably in the range of 40 to 50%. The mass energy of the universe. So our kind of matter, protons and neutrons, are electrons are fairly small. Let's us just say at about the next level where they do excrement, they can still, they are probably consisting of another kind of matter that still has mass, but is much more configurable. And it's said also about in the kama-loka that devas has to eat every meal. If they miss one meal, then they die. They evaporate, so to speak. So they are much more dependent upon their meals. They are very fine, but and they also have to be very mindful about it, fulfilling all meals, because otherwise they basically die. So their chemical attraction of molecules is much more subtle. They can typically change color, they can change form, they can become a small membrane, or come to look like a cloud. They become one. They can become many. They can change their physical form after free will, depending on what level they are. The higher the level, the more freedom of changing their form they can do. If we go, they still can. They still have excrement, but those on the higher levels that are made out of basically, that have form still, but also changeable form, can appear as light, as whatever, and that feed on joy, they do not have excrement. And they can correspond to, if you're made out of light, light doesn't have mass, but we regard photons, whether it's a particle aspect in the form of photons, or it's a wave aspect in the form of radiation, then we repart. We regard this currently as a material phenomenon. So gravity waves, light waves, radioactive waves, X-rays, gamma rays, and so on, it's material phenomenon. This is basically what they are made of. So they have form, but it's an exceedingly subtle form. Basically, they're made out of light. So they can take up any form they want. They don't have any particular form. In the case of light, at the Abhasara Devas, there was somebody who asked a monk at the Buddhist time, a very intelligent question actually, when they meet together, how can they recognize each other if they're just light and light and light? You cannot see who's who. And then the monk said, it's true, when they're close to each other, then they cannot say who is who. They communicate telepathically. But he said, when they depart from each other and go out in space, dark space, then they could recognize each other's the extent of the radius of the radiance and the color that go out there like a receding star or receding planet, then they could recognize each other by name. And this, he also mentioned that the extent of the radiance and the color of the radiance, the glow of it, would what was karmically determined. And so they asked him, since he was an enlightened monk, since he could remember and provide this very specific information, whether he recently had been an Abhasara Deva. And then he said, yes, he had been an Abhasara Deva. And he could remember his life as an Abhasara Deva. You typically remember from millions to billions former lives, at least 400,000 lives, at the night of enlightenment. And he had could remember his Abhasara Deva life. And remember these meetings where there was light all over the place and laughter, because they're very joyous, very joyous. And then the light, individual lights, bulbs of lights or radiance of lights, spheres of light receding out in each direction in space. And thereby identifying who's who. You could remember this subtle and very technical, you can say, fact, which I think just in itself, actually, when I got this information first time, then I said to myself, this is something that you cannot make up. This is something that you cannot, a poet or someone who is fantasizing or making legends, they cannot make up such a detail, such a technical detail, that beings made of light cannot recognize each other when close, but they can when they depart. You have to experience that directly in order to tell about it. It is too weird, too fantastic not to be real, I would say, in my opinion. But there are probably many opinions about that too, that fact too. So again, the lower devas have subtle bodies that can change. They might be made of other molecules, other elementary particles that we not have discovered yet. They do excrement. The higher devas, the rupa-loka, fine material devas, are probably made of the thing we call dark matter, that don't reflect light and don't give out light and don't make a shadow, but have mass and make up 40% of the universe. Then there are some devas, four level of devas above them, again in the arupa levels, that are formless, and they neither do have any form nor any body, and of course don't eat food or excrement, have excrement. So excrement is something that pertains to the lower kama-loka devas, level 6 to level 11. I hope this answer this question. And so many were the words for today. Again, I give the link here on the video of the 31 levels of existence and the two Dhamma drops I made up in Remember the Deities and Divinity Contemplation. They will come rolling down here while I say thank you for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thank you to all the Daikas, supporters and donors, in particular those who gave food here last time, and those who give a small donation every month to make the wheels running here and to keep upgrading the technical equipment. Next up is a new serious hardcore computer to make 4K videos on, expensive. And then also thank you to those who support the Dhammasala, the meditation hall. Remember to subscribe, the small bell, and look for the meditation courses. And may you have indeed a nice and noble day. Silence is bliss. Namo. Tassu.
Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable. And perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you and have a nice day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution and have a nice day.